Hello, dear students. Welcome to NIOS Studio. I, Dr. Gitika Datta, who I am principal of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan's Lilavati Munshi College of Education, New Delhi. Today, we are going to study a very, very important topic, that is self-concept. Now, supposing I ask you a question, who are you? Or describe yourself. What kind of an answer will you give me? Now, if I ask the same question to you, say 5 years from now, describe yourself or who are you? Do you think you will give me the same kind of an answer which you have given me today? And now if we ask the same question to say a class 3 student who is 7 to 8 years old or a class 1 student, who are you? So this is basically about, or the concept, the self-concept is about describing yourself, that is understanding of your own self. Now so if we ask the question to say, for example, a very small child who is 3 years old, so this is a kind of an answer which I am sure will get, that I am Ranjit, I am 3 years old, I love my tricycle, it was given to me by my grandparents or grand aunt or whosoever, I love playing with my friends, I like doing this, I like doing that, I love my mama, I love my papa, and these are the kinds of answers which a very small child will give. Another child who is say a 4-year-old, I am Tina, I am 4 years old, I have a new red racket, I like playing with it, I don't want to share it with Rina. So if we see, this is how, or how does, now basically now we'll try to understand how this concept of self develops among children. Are we actually born with it, or is it, does it continue over a period of time? How does it develop? So answers to a 3 to 4 5-year-old children will generally give us things like, I am so and so, my name is so and so, our physical appearances, whether I am a girl or a boy, possessions, what kind of possessions do I have? I have a ball, I have a red cycle, I have a tricycle, things like that. My likings, dislikings, emotions, I like certain things, I don't like certain things, my attitudes, etc. So these are the essential, you can say, essential contributors of my concept, or a concept of children at very young age. Now, as we grow older, this concept keeps on improvising, it keeps on elaborating, and we are able to develop, or we are able to understand more about our own self. Now, if we look into the definition of self-concept, the set of attributes, abilities and values that an individual believes who he or she is. So here we are talking of three different constructs, psychological constructs, that is attributes, abilities and values. This definition is given to us by Laura E. Burke. So what are the essential characteristics of self-concept? The overall image or awareness that we have of ourselves. The perception of I or me, who am I? Feelings, beliefs, values, attitudes, perceptions about our own self, and it is comprised of a variety of selves. Now, variety of selves means I see myself differently with my own self. I may see myself differently with my friends. I may see myself differently with parents or families or extended family or among strangers. So we will see what different kinds of selves can we have. The academic self. Academic self means I would want, or I have some kind of an understanding about how am I academically. The artistic self means how am I in artistic terms. The athletic self, that is how am I with respect to games, physical exercises and sports, etc. The emotional self, that means how do I understand myself in terms of emotions, whether I am a very moody person, whether I am a very stable person. The moral self, whether I am moral most of the times, whether I am immoral most of the times. So basically it describes us different kinds of selves. We also have an understanding of the ideal self. Ideal self is a concept which is little different, we need to understand that. Ideal self is a set of understandings or expectations that we understand others have of us. Say for example, our parents, our teachers. So children, small children, they do get to understand what do their parents or what do their teachers expect them to be. And so they form this concept of the ideal self. This is how I am supposed to be. Now, if they find, now here's a catch here, if they find themselves to be as per the expectations of their parents or teachers, they are happy with themselves. But if they find themselves lagging, then it gives rise to a very low self-esteem, a concept which we'll discuss a little later. The social self. Now, social self is basically how we perceive others perceive us, or how do we think that others understand us as people. So, these were the different kinds of selves. Now, we'll try to understand what factors, I mean, what determines actually about my own concept or about anybody's concept about self-concept. So, we'll see that our self-concept is guided by physical conditions, the children's physical conditions, my own physical condition, your physical conditions, children's physical conditions. So, if they are happy, they are healthy individuals, they will come across or they will form that kind of a self-concept. Now, here we need to understand certain things, like there are certain children who are identified as children with special needs. Now, they may have certain kind of disabilities. So, they may have a different kind or a negative kind, they may develop a different or negative kind of a self-concept. So, the teachers as well as the parents or the family have to be very, very cautious about not giving that kind of impression that the children are lagging somewhat, basically celebrating their differentness, celebrating the diversity and celebrating whatever abilities they have. If these conditions are met, the students with whether they are normal students, the so-called normal students, or whether they are children with special needs, they will develop positive, healthy self-concept. It is also determined by body build. What kind of a body build do I have? Now, these days with the influence of media and other things, children are extremely cautious about how they look. Now, if they are happy with their looks, they will definitely find or they will develop a healthy self-concept. But if they are not so happy, if they feel that I am too thin, I am too fat, I am too tall, I am too short, or my hair doesn't look nice, my nose doesn't look nice, their self-concept will be according to that in a little negative manner. The names and the nicknames which are given to them by their families, friends, etc., etc. Now, names are proper names which are given to all children by their families, and the nicknames by which they call them. Some children may be extremely embarrassed by the nicknames given to them by their parents or their family members or their friends, depending upon different other conditions. Supposing somebody is, say, very slow to do things, so the friends may call this person tortoise or, you know, slow person, things like that. So, if these kinds of nicknames are given to children, children may feel very happy about them, may feel very bad about them, and that basically influences their self-concept. The overall school environment. The school environment also plays a very, very important role in developing children's self-concept. If the school provides learning opportunities to all children, if the school environment is a healthy environment and they provide various kinds of teaching learning experiences which help the students in, say, organizing, they are a part of group activities, individual activities, or some other activities which give them all round exposure and some opportunities to prove themselves in different manner, then students or children will come up with a very positive self-concept. Social acceptance. How do children perceive whether they are being accepted socially or no? If they are socially accepted by their peers, which is extremely important for any child, so children will develop a positive self-concept. Whereas if the children feel that they are not being accepted socially or in the family or by their peer group or by their siblings, they may develop a negative kind of a self-concept. Successes and failures. This is something which is extremely important. The more chances or the more evidence of successes a person or a child achieves or a person experiences, the more are the chances of that person building up a positive self-concept. If a child or a person keeps on experiencing failures repeatedly over a number of period of time, then the person may develop a negative kind of a self-concept. So it is extremely important that if we want our children to develop a positive self-concept, to feel good about themselves, we need to give them experiences of success to each and every child, irrespective of the age and stage. It is also true of grown-ups, the adults also. Everybody of us need to feel good about our own selves. Now, you people are pursuing teacher education. You also have this need of experiencing success. If we experience success, we feel good about ourselves. If we don't experience success, we do not feel good about ourselves, which gives rise to self-concept. Gender. Gender is again a very important, you can say, one of the important conditions. In some societies or in some households, we would say, certain kind of preferences are given to some one particular gender. So it is intrinsically because of the repeated experiences at home or at school or between family members, children of a particular gender may feel themselves to be superior, and children of certain other genders may find themselves or feel themselves to be inferior. So self-concept is also governed by gender. These days we also talk about the third gender. Now third gender people are people who have been traditionally or historically rejected even by their own family members. So it is a psychological fact that children or persons belonging to the third gender, they find themselves to be generally lacking in something which is very, very important, and they may have developed a negative self-concept because of the conditions and the environment which is given to them. Another very important criteria is the intelligence. Our society basically favors people who are high on intelligence, people who can understand things quickly, who can understand and retain things quickly, and plus people who can, or children who can be a huge success in academic terms. So intelligence plays a very, very important role. So people who are bestowed with intelligence or high levels of intelligence, they generally develop a positive self-concept because this is the kind of experience which they get from their environment also. Whereas children who are little low on intelligence are more prone to developing negative self-concept. Another very important criteria is the family relations and acceptance. Now, family relations, irrespective of the kind of abilities a person has, irrespective of the kind of gender a person belongs to, irrespective of the kind of intelligence a child is born with, if the family is supportive, if the family is accommodating, and if the family is giving them right kind of experiences, the child will definitely develop a positive self-concept and will be ready to accept himself or herself. Now, there are certain very important, we can say, influences of culture on the development of self-concept. Now, number of researches have been conducted in this particular field, and they have pointed out to this thing that the Western cultures, who are considered to be more individualistic in nature, they focus on individual and individuality. Children from those Western cultures, they are reported to be very high on self-concept and self-evaluation. That is much better than they actually are. So they are very high, I like this, I like that, and they think of themselves as compared to, or researchers have also found out that they consider themselves to much superior than they actually are. Whereas in Eastern cultures, which are generally considered to be more collectivistic rather than individualistic, and focus on family or society is given more. So they focus on cooperation and maintaining social harmony. People do not express themselves, or children do not express themselves, in over optimistic and individualistic manner. They will consider themselves to be a part of a group. I belong to such and such class. I belong to this family. So that kind of self-concept generally develops among children. Okay. Now there is another connected concept which is related to self-concept, that is self-esteem. Now, many times people do not distinguish between self-concept and self-esteem, whereas these are two separate concepts, and we need to understand the difference between self-concept and self-esteem. Now, what is the difference? Now, self-esteem is basically the evaluative side of self-concept. Now, what do you mean by this evaluative side? It can be defined as the sense of contentment and self-acceptance that results from a person's appraisal of one's own worth, attractiveness, competence, and ability to satisfy one's aspirations. Now, what does this mean? Say, for example, I have developed the self-concept that I am a very lively person, I like to be with friends, and I want to do things in a group. And there might be some other person who may think that, okay, I am an individual, I like to be with my own self, and I am kind of introvert, I want to spend time, I need some time for my own self. Now, self-esteem would be, this is the objective understanding of two people according to their own distinct. This is the self-concept which is devoid of any emotions or which is devoid of any kind of evaluation attached to it. Now, if I start feeling very bad or good about this thing, okay, I am so happy that I am this kind of a person, whereas the other person start feeling so, not so happy or a little dejected that I am introvert. And this happens. Many of our society or generally it is perceived that people who are kind of introverts, they are, introversion is not considered to be good, which is again a kind of, it's not correct from the psychological point of view. So, a person feeling happy or unhappy about his or her self-concept is self-esteem. The judgments that we make about our own worth and the feelings associated with those judgments is self-esteem. Both are reflective processes. Now, self-concept as well as self-esteem, both are reflective processes. Now, we'll try to see or let us try to answer these questions. Do you like your appearance when you see yourself in the mirror? Answer yes or no. Do you feel comfortable with yourself most of the time? Do you savor accomplishments? Many of us, yes, many of us don't. If somebody tries to give us a compliment, you're looking so nice or your work is very good. No, it's basically because of this, basically because of that. So, do you savor accomplishments? Do you express your opinions freely? Do you listen to others even if you disagree? Do you give credit to others when it is due? Do you accept compliments graciously? Many of us may do that, many of us do not do that. Do you make realistic demands on yourself? Now, if the answer to all of these questions or most of these questions is yes, this is an indicator of a positive self-esteem or you can say a good self-esteem. And if the answers to most of these questions happen to be no, then that means the self-concept or self-esteem is going on the lower side. Now, let us try to understand the difference between self-concept and self-esteem. Self-concept, as we already have discussed, it is the objective knowledge of our own self. It is the informational side of ourself, the objective answer to the question, who am I? And the factual description of how you perceive your own self. Whereas self-esteem, if we see, it is the general attitude about yourself, about your own self, that whatever self-concept that you have developed, whether you are happy or whether you are not so happy with your developed self-concept, the extent to which we approve or value ourselves and our own feelings towards our own self-concept. Now, let us take an example. There are two children and both the children have been branded as notorious and very, very naughty by the parents also, teachers also, fellow students also, and they are children of primary classes. Now, generally what happens is in primary classes, children are very sensitive about how teachers or their parents, what kind of comments do they give. So, based on all the things from the environment, they have gathered these things about themselves, that we are notorious, we are very, very naughty, and we cannot do much in life. This is what the parents also keep on telling them and the teachers also keep on telling them. Now, there is one child who is not so happy about it, feels very bad about this kind of a self-concept which has been developed because he keeps on hearing these things over and over and over again from others. And he doesn't feel very good about himself and he feels that he is not going to, he won't be able to do much in life. Whereas the other child may be extremely happy about it. Okay, if I have been labeled notorious, if I have been labeled naughty, that means I am supposed to be naughty. And is very good and very happy about it and he goes about doing things in whatever manner and which actually satisfy or which actually keep on proving the evaluations or the opinions of others in a positive manner. So these are known as self-fulfilling prophecies also. We feed certain things in the mind of the child, and the child does things in order to prove those things correct. So this is how it doesn't, there is no connection, or that the point which I am trying to make is that it is not certain that a person who develops a positive self-concept will also have generally positive self-esteem. A person who has a negative self-concept may also have a high self-esteem. A person who has a positive self-concept may also have a lower level of self-esteem. For example, a child who is coming from a family of very, very high achievers. The child understands that I am somebody who is quite intelligent. I can do many things on my own. I understand things quickly. I want to be a part of group. I want to do activities. I am interested in music. I am interested in mathematics or whatsoever. But other family members or his or her, siblings are doing much greater than this person. So the self-concept, the self-esteem may be even lower in case of this child. So we can say that self-concept and self-esteem are quite different. Now we'll try to see what are the components of the global self-esteem. So global means the overall self-esteem of a person. So it comprises of the physical attractiveness, the physical abilities which a person can do. I can ride a bicycle, I can swim, I can do dancing, I can do aerobics, etc., etc. Cognitive abilities, that is related to your mental abilities. I am interested in languages, I am interested in mathematics, I am interested in social sciences or whatsoever. Social relationships, whether I am able to get along with others, my parents like me, my friends like me, I am worried about whether the girls in my class like me or no, or the boys in my class like me or no. So these are social relationships. Other factors are subjective sense of significance, whether what do I perceive of my own self, whether I am a significant person or no. Now, this is a very important aspect of self-esteem we would want to understand, or everybody, if this sense of significance is high, the person will have a high self-esteem. If this sense of significance is low, that means I do not matter, the self-esteem will be low. Worthiness, again a repetition of the point that how much worth a person I am. Appearance and social acceptability, these days appearances do matter. People are very, very conscious about the way they appear to others, and everybody wants to appear their best. And social acceptability to a large extent depends on the appearance of a person. If somebody doesn't appear nice, and this is the problem when we are talking in case of inclusive classroom, there may be certain people, certain children with special needs who may appear different than others. So their self-concept and their self-esteem may take a dip. So teachers as well as parents, they have to work on these aspects at children from whatever background, whether they are children with special needs or whether they are other children, they should develop a positive self-esteem. Resilience and determination. Resilience is very important in the sense, resilience basically means bouncing back. Supposing I have encountered a failure in a task. So resilience would be about how do I bounce back, whether will I bounce back or no. So people who bounce back readily or more easily, they have a higher level of self-esteem. And whereas people who do not, people who are not willing to try again, they generally have a lower self-esteem. See, it's basically about taking risks. A student or a child who is already low on self-esteem will not want to take lot of chances. It's like having money with you. If you have lot of money, you can take chances with money, you can afford to spend. So even if your money goes waste, you will still have this sense ki okay, I still have some money left with me. But yes, same is the case with emotions also. Say for example, if somebody has encountered failure, and this is a person who has a very high self-esteem, in that case what will happen is the person will tend to try again and think that okay, even if I lose again, what will happen? My self-esteem can go a little low, but the person will be willing to take chances. Whereas a person who is already very low on self-esteem would not want to take those chances. So it's a kind of a cyclical process. People with high self-esteem will be more resilient. People with high resilience will be having more self-esteem. Control over personal destiny. How important or how do we think that can we control our personal destiny? If yes, people will have high self-esteem. Value of existence. So is our existence of any value to us, to family members, to our personal life, to our professional life, to our school life, with our peers, with our partners? So these questions are extremely important in determining the self-esteem of children as well as people. Now, what are the influences? What are the influencing factors on self-esteem? Let us try to discuss those things. Significant childhood experiences. Now, this self-concept and self-esteem keeps on developing, or it's a continuous process. It's an ever-evolving process, and it starts from right from the very beginning, from the early childhood, and it goes on. Generally, it is said that childhood does not end with childhood. So what does this mean? Basically, it means that the experiences that we have encountered in our childhood, those experiences actually have a very great impact on us, our sense of self, our self-concept, self-esteem, and our personality. So the kind of experiences that we have in our childhood, those experiences actually, you can say, that determines our self-esteem. Our own standards, the kind of standards which we have for our own self, child-rearing practices, it basically, what kind of parenting practices we have, parents who are warm, who have reasonable demands with their children, and who are able to provide a kind of a warm, appropriate, and supportive environment to their children, those children will be high on self-esteem. Whereas parents who are kind of, they are not able to provide a supportive environment, or they are kind of impulsive. At one point of time, they are saying something else. At other point of time, they are saying something else. Children tend to get confused, and it has an impact on their self-esteem. Cultural influences are there. So certain cultures or gender stereotypes are there, like we already discussed, in some households or societies, people prefer certain genders or certain cultural influences or certain languages. So those things have an impact on the self-esteem. Media, these days media is a very important, it's a very important influencer. Media determines what is good and what is bad. If the media says lean is in, people who are not so lean will not feel good about themselves. If the media says lean is in, people who are lean or thin, they will feel good about themselves. And if you see these days on internet, there are so many advertisements telling us lose weight, lose 5 kgs, lose 10 kgs, and people who are a little on the higher side, they start feeling very bad about themselves. So media plays a very, very important role on the self-esteem of people. Or media may say, or media may advocate certain kinds of cultural trends, media may say certain other kinds of things, etc., etc. Experiences of successes and failure, this is the most important thing. Each and every child needs to feel success about himself or herself. And these successes and failures are very important for developing the self-esteem of a person. Now, let us try to see the effects of high and low self-esteem. So, children with high self-esteem will have positive feelings. They will have higher expectations from themselves. They are more likely to persist in case of failure, and they are better at managing interpersonal relations. Whereas people with low self-esteem, they will have negative feelings, they will have lower expectations from oneself. They tend to give up easily. They tend to remain in abusive relationships because they feel that there is something inherently wrong with them only. And feelings of inferiority and lower level of confidence in general. Now, self-concept and role of teachers. What is the role of teachers? How can teachers help in developing a positive kind of a self-concept? So, it's possible. First of all, we need to understand that it is possible to change self-concept, and this change can be in either direction. It can be positive also, it can be negative also, and it's not easy and speedy. It takes time, and it happens over a period of time. Efforts on central beliefs have to have a greater impact. Central beliefs means my intrinsic qualities or intrinsic qualities of children. Say if a child believes that the child cannot do much, then this is a central belief. So the teachers have to take into account this kind of a belief and build activities in which the students experiences success. Peripheral experiences are helpful. Relating successes and failures of one another is important. Relating successes and failures of children discussing their successes, children discussing their failures to one another, this is very important in developing positive self-concept. Other ways are creating an open and caring environment, encouraging children to strive for worthwhile goals, praising for efforts rather than innate abilities. Hey, for example, we shouldn't be praising child, oh, you are so intelligent. No, we should be saying you have made great efforts. Otherwise, what will happen is a child who is not so great on intelligence will tend to feel bad. So the focus or emphasis has to be on effort rather than the innate capabilities. Opportunities to be given to each and every child to experience success, which is very, very important. This is a point which is coming up again and again, and this is something which I would like to emphasize. So these are some of the useful strategies in inclusive classrooms, reflective diaries, reflective questions and games, sharing accomplishments in groups, game using a magic box with mirrors and coming and asking children to come and say who is the special person, and children discovering themselves and then talking about themselves, their positive points. Sharing values in groups and reasons for choosing those values. These are some of the activities which are very considered to be very great. Sharing moments of pride, sharing moments of success, acting as if, supposing if you are this person, if you are that person, you are the teacher, you are the principal, you are the prime minister, things like that. And if I were students and asking them and coming out with, making them come out with their own, you can say experiences and opinions. So students, this was all about the concept of self, this was all about self-concept. How self-concept develops over a period of time, right from the very beginning to till the end of our life, and how, what is the difference between self-concept and self-esteem, and how we as teachers can contribute towards making a positive self-concept and self-esteem amongst our students. So being teachers, I feel that this is something which is very important. Content may or may not be meaningful tomorrow, but if we are able to develop positive self-concept and a positive self-esteem among our students, our job as teachers, our job as educators will be realized. Thank you so much, and all the best to you.